आई एम टेकिंग ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स इनसाइड द व्यू.
Am I audible?
Yes, madam.
Okay, so may I start?
Yes, madam.
A very good afternoon to one and all present over here. I, Rashmi Singh, on behalf of Truba College of Science and Technology, Bhopal, extend a warm and hearty welcome to all dignitaries, expert of the day, faculties, and all dear students. In this digital era, power of machine learning makes digital apps more relevant and effective. Microsoft Azure is a very flexible platform which allows to prepare machine learning models with less time, and also a large organizations of the world use this platform for data analytics. To explain this, our today's online workshop on the topic Hands-on Machine Learning on Cloud is sponsored by TechCube 3 RGPV Bhopal. TechCube 3 is implemented by MHRD and World Bank with the objective of improving the quality of technical education in the country. RGPV is selected by MHRD as one of the affiliating technical universities among 10 across the country for receiving TechCube 3 grant. RGPV TechCube 3 is targeted to improve the quality of technical education in approximately 180 affiliated engineering institutes across Madhya Pradesh. So, the objective of this workshop is to improve the knowledge of students and faculty in the field of machine learning on cloud. This session will help the students and faculty members to learn how to prepare machine learning models through cloud-based platform and deploy them so that end users can consume and utilize the models. In this session, participants can learn about Azure Machine Learning, that is a cloud-based environment, and they can use to train, deploy, automate, manage, and track machine learning models. The motive of this workshop is to provide the conceptual, detailed, practical exposure about this field to the student and faculty members from the industrial expert. Now, I request Professor Manoj Tyagi, HOD CSE Department and in charge principal, Truba College of Science and Technology, to deliver the welcome address.
Thank you, madam. Good afternoon to all dignitaries, keynote speaker, respected HODs, faculty members, students, and all participants. I heartily welcome to all of you in this event. I feel privileged to welcome our honorable guest, Dr. S.C. Chaubey sir, Coordinator Technical Education Quality Improvement Program, RGPV. Shri Shyam Rathore ji, Chairman Truba Group of Institutes. Dr. Rajiv Arya, Director Truba Institute of Engineering and Information Technology. Your presence is motivational and inspirational for us. Your guidance and continuous support encourage us to learn and share the knowledge about the new technologies. It is a proud moment for us that you all accepted dignity. You all respected dignitaries gave your precious time for this event and encourage us by your gracious presence. I feel honored to extend my warm welcome to our keynote speaker, Shri Vaibhav Jain, Senior Data Scientist, Indigo Airline, Gurgaon, Haryana. It is great pleasure for our institute that you accepted our request and taken time out of your busy schedule to guide our participants by giving practical exposure on topic Machine Learning on Cloud using Microsoft Azure. I also welcome Dr. Gina Harjeet, all HODs, faculty members, and all participants in this event. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable words. It is a great pleasure of mine to invite Dr. S.C. Chaubey, Professor and Dean Faculty of Electrical Engineering Department, UIT RGPV Bhopal, and Coordinator TechCube, under whose able guidance we have seen a remarkable remarkable achievement of TechCube activities in the form of FDP, STTP, webinars, and conferences. Sir, it's a great pleasure to have you with us. Sir? Sir, welcome, sir.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Sri Shyam Rathorji, Chairman, Tribha Group of Institutions, Coordinator of this program, Manoj Tyagiji, Dr. Rashmi Singh, Sunal Yadav, and professors, faculty members of Tribha Group of Institutions, and all participants present here from RGPV affiliated institutions. I had been several times at this platform, and I found all the times when Tribha Group of Institutions is organizing any program, it's very, very relevant to the need of the students and fulfilling the demand of the day. This time again, they have come with a very relevant topic. Why it is so? Society has got some expectation from an engineer or from a particularly from a computer science engineer, IT engineer, that what they know about the cloud. Very every time we hear about the clouds, what even when we are buying any procurement during the procurement of various software, our first requirement was that whether it is available on the cloud or not, so that our faculty of our affiliated institutions can use this software at their own stay. So this was the basic requirement right now. As a student, as a faculty, when we do not know that how the cloud is working, how what is the cloud computation, we have got Aneka cloud computing software. Nobody is ready to work on this Aneka. How this machine learning models can be hosted on the clouds. So this is so relevant that every student and faculty should know about. And I found even we have to consult different people who are working in a different agencies. And as a faculty, we do not know those things. So this is a time where our faculty member can get the knowledge about the cloud computing. This is the time we can our faculty members can impart their knowledge, can pass their knowledge to the students that what is the importance of cloud computing. And particularly, I would like to appreciate Sri Vaibhav Jainji, who had been here and talking on cloud computation. Probably he will also tell what is the role of or what is the scope of employment. When students know about this, where he can get deputed and what is the role of cloud computing, when it is how one institute can come working on the cloud computing. So far we have restricted cloud computation, cloud computing on our own syllabus. We have not gone outside what the practical implementation is. Even when we are hosting one of the software model. So this was started with the thing that there is no need of the cloud space, cloud computations. And when we started working on the Moodle, then we could realize that there is a space, there is a certain computational features which we have to hire from either Google, like this. So this kind of knowledge should be there. They should have, our faculty members should have that where we should go, in which agency we should go so that we can get the cheapest one, how much cloud storage is required. Even we do not have a computing facilities, and why for 1 hour we can buy certain computational feature for our R&D purpose, for 1 hour we'll pay for 1 hour, why we should go for 24 hours. So these all the features will come up while Mr. Jain will be delivering. And once again, I congratulate to the management of Tribha Group of Institutions for taking up so burning topics for the students and faculty. And I hope that all the advantage which you can take from the Tech3 and RGPV are already there on the board. And I wish to thank Professor Sunil Kumar, Anil Vice Chancellor, for giving all kinds of support for the empowering students and faculty. I wish to thank all coordinators and professors, stakeholders of Turbo Group of Institutions who are present here. Okay, thank you very much. Over to.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable Thank you, sir, for your valuable insight on this topic. It is my esteemed privilege to invite Shri Shyam Rathore, sir, Chairman, Truba Group of Institutes, who is the patron and guiding line for all the students and faculties of Truba Group of Institutes. Sir, please enlighten us with your knowledge-worthy words.
Thank you, Rashmi. Good afternoon, everyone. And my special thanks to Chobe sir for every time giving his precious knowledge and sharing the things with us. And I congratulate all the participants, and I especially congratulate the team Truba for making this event so successful. Today, for me, it's one of the emotional days because we have completed around 21 years of Truba setup. Tomorrow we will be having the foundation day, but kal Sunday hai, to isliye aaj aap usko maan sakte hain. और 21 साल पहले का मुझे याद है, जब कंप्यूटर खरीदते थे तब बात होती थी कितने सर्वर हैं, कितने कंप्यूटर हैं, क्या कॉन्फ़िगरेशन है, हर सीपीयू में कितनी मेमोरी है. जब से क्लाउड कंप्यूटिंग और जब सिस्टम चेंज हुआ है, तो आप देखिए, ऑल वी नीड इज ओनली बैंडविड्थ एंड द प्रोसेस फ्रॉम वेयर वी कैन रीच द क्लाउड एंड वी कैन डू अवर थिंग्स. सो इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर शेयरिंग इज वन ऑफ द इम्पोर्टेंट आस्पेक्ट इन कमिंग ईयर्स. सो ब्रिक एंड मोर्टार colleges will be no more in the part of the system, and we will be going to cloud computing and all the new technologies, ML and AI and all those things. And once again, thank you very much and congratulations to all the team for organizing such a nice program and giving me an opportunity to be a part of this. Go ahead with your knowledge for the students. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Your address has paved way to understand the topic. Now, I request Professor Chandan Kumar, coordinator of this event, to introduce and welcome our today's expert.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. As a coordinator of this event, I am very delighted to take an opportunity to introduce our expert, Mr. Vaibhav Jain, who is a senior data scientist in IndiGo Interglobe Aviation Limited Airlines, Gurgaon, Haryana. He has done his master degree from BITS Pilani in the area of advanced analytics. He is also certified in business analytics from Indian School of Business. Actually, he has started his career as a software developer and business analyst from Tata Consultancy Services. After that, he has explored himself as a senior analyst in Nomura Financial Services. He has also worked as a data scientist in JLT Group. Then he has started working as a consultant analytics in KPMG Global Services. Currently, he is working as a data science manager in IndiGo Aviation Limited. He has been building data science projects over the years and also working with various organizations, teams, clients, domains across the geographic using several techniques like deep learning, face recognition, object detection, image recognition, natural language processing, sentiment analysis, topic modeling, chatbots, and many more. Currently, he is working on advanced analytics projects with India's largest air carrier that do flight operations, which is called as the heart of any airlines. He is also involved in many areas like building the analytics and consulting teams, setting up analytics pipeline, which caters every bit of a data science project lifecycle, identifying the tools and technologies tech for the various projects, liaising with the external vendors for the same. Also, organizing training for various teams and their members for making them better equipped with analytical framework. Last but not the least, his key skills are statistical analysis, data visualization, data collection, data management, business fundamentals, operations management, simulation, financial analytics, customer analytics for new product development, data mining, operational management, optimization strategy and analytics for digital and social media, and machine learning as a service on cloud, Amazon Web Service, as well as Microsoft Azure. Now I request Mr. Vaibhav to continue the session, and I request all the participants to kindly keep them mute. Thank you, sir.
Thanks a lot, Chandan sir. I like to thank all the dignitaries, Vice Chancellor sir, head of the department, all the faculty members, and all the students, my colleagues who are with us, and they have thought to come and attend this talk. And I hope this talk is beneficial to the students as well as to the faculty members. And I'm just sharing my screen and just starting. Okay. So I'll be keeping this talk interactive. Like, if you have any questions, you can note down the questions and ask. In between also you can ask, and after the talk also, after the demonstration also you can ask. I have divided this session particularly in two parts, one being the demonstration of theoretical concepts of machine learning on cloud, and then I will be demonstrating one experiment on the cloud, which is Machine Learning Studio, Microsoft, where I will be telling you how you can, right from the data import, how you can import your data, which is either in your hard drive or in your any other repository, and then how you can develop your models, clean the data, a quick demonstration, and then how you can deploy it in Microsoft Azure Machine Learning Studio just with some few clicks, and there is no hard coding required. So it will be very beneficial, I think, to the students who are thinking to go into the machine learning and deep learning, advanced analytics area. And I will also be focusing on some highlights on what the corporates or the organization require, what basically is the trend in corporate. So all these things I will be demonstrating in my today's talk. So, okay. So just sharing my screen. Okay. Okay. So just starting with the life cycle of a machine learning project. So I'm just starting with this. So this is the basic structure which we follow in corporate. When you prepare a machine learning project, from where you have to start, from where you have to end, this is same as the software development life cycle, which is SDLC, we call it. And this is, I think, the same in most of the organizations. So this is why this is helpful for students, because many times we don't know from where to start, where to end, what is the process of a data science project life cycle. So I like to throw some light on this. So on the left hand side, you see this is a cross project infrastructure, where when starting a machine learning project, we basically decide the team and hiring. So if you see, we have various roles in machine learning project also. Starting from the data import, we have a data engineer, basically, whose job is basically to set up the pipeline, take out the data from various sources. It can be unstructured data, structured data. Unstructured data being like logs, images, and structured data basis, tabular form, transactional data. So the data engineer job is basically to fetch out that data and make a pipeline so that data gets stored in some area, whether it can be a data lake, it can be a data warehouse, it can be some sort of a database. So this is a job of data engineer. Okay. Then we have a person who basically cleans or profiles the data. So when data gets stored from various sources, the job of a data basically profiler is to clean the data, discover what is inside the data. We'll be doing this all these steps in the hands-on. And what he does is either cleaning the missing values or duplicates or whatever is required. He prepares the data basically for the model. And then we have a stage which is their model development stage and feature engineering, which is required. So model development stage is basically where a person who is a machine learning engineer basically develops the model, writes some algorithms on top of that data and develops some algorithms so that we get some insights in form of predictions, in form of forecast, in form of insights, basically the insights from that data. And then we have a person who is basically a model tester or same as we have testers in the testing team in this, who basically tests the accuracy of the model, checks whether how the model is performing. So this is the role of a model tester basically. And then we have a last model deployment expert who deploys the model either on cloud or on any platform or any app. And he also makes sure that the visualization of the data is correct. So we have a data visualization person also. So this is basically how the team is divided. Many times, most of the tasks are done by same person. If you are expert in these, many times if we have a large project which is running, then these tasks are divided into various persons who have their specifications. So this, therefore, team and hiring is important for which task you have, which guy. Then we have infra and tooling. So infra and tooling, we basically see that for the project, whether you require GPU, whether you require CPU, computation power, basically, whether you require your project to be on cloud, which type of tools you require for data cleaning, whether they are open source, closed source. Apart from that, you also see how the visualization is done, so for that, there are visualization tools like Power BI, Tableau, there are other also. So then the infrastructure and tooling is important. So therefore, in the left hand side, cross project infrastructure is very important for a person who is thinking to develop a machine learning project. And then on the right hand side, I can tell you that these are the steps which I have already told you, that we have a per project activities, planning and project setup, where you define your goals, you choose your metrics, you evaluate your business line, you set up a code base. And this will be very important because when dealing with client, when taking any project, these all steps are followed. Data collection and labeling, you have strategy for that, how you want to collect your data, ingest your data, how you want to import your data. Most of these steps we'll be doing in our hands-on. Labeling, how you label your data. And then you choose your training and debugging, where you choose your models and then you train, test them, and then you prioritize for improvement after testing the accuracy. And then you deploy your model in production. And after testing, again, deployment and monitoring, then it goes to the maintenance phase. So this is a typical life cycle of a project. And then now moving from this lifestyle, life cycle of a project, we are entering into machine learning project. Basically, what are the components of a machine learning project? So for components of machine learning project, I will be going through all these components in detail. Like, for example, if you see, this is data preparation for analysis. We'll be doing this step. So how you will be doing the data preparation for analysis, where you will be, I'll be demonstrating you import and export of data and from Azure Machine Learning. And I also wanted to share why I chose Azure because first of all, Azure is very friendly, and it's a very GUI, in terms of GUI, graphic user interface, it's very flexible and it's very easy to learn. Very less coding required for most of the tasks. It also has a facility to have Python and R script embed into the tool so that you can also customize your model or the task or the experiment which you are doing in. Okay, so it has the capability of embedding Python and R scripts also. And then parallelly, you can train a lot of models and you can evaluate between your models. And a lot of functions are also there. In terms of AWS, when you see AWS is also there, we have also worked. So this is also one more platform, AWS, which is Amazon Web Service provided by Amazon, where you can also compute and create models in Amazon SageMaker. But somehow it's up to your choice. I bend more into Azure because of the UI and because of the friendliness and because of the number of models which are provided. But Azure is also, AWS is also there. Now, for up to certain limit, I will also be sharing you and telling you how you can create your account in Microsoft Azure Machine Learning Studio, which looks like this. So you can go to Google Azure Machine Learning Studio, and it will Microsoft Azure Machine Learning Studio link will come up. The first link will be there. You can click on this link. It will take you to the account creation area where you can create your account. I have a manual. I will be sharing that manual with you where you can easily create. So right now I have logged in from my account, so it's showing me all that. In the manual, if you see, it's free of cost, and it's free of cost at up to certain GBs, and I think which will be very useful for the experimentation. So this is the process. So after clicking on that, it will take you to this page, and then you can sign up here, and from sign up it will take you, so you can see that it has free workspace from up to 10 GB storage. So you can use 10 GB storage here, and up to 10 GB of your data, it is free of cost. And then also after this, you can use an 8-hour trial. So you can enter up to 8 hours, you can work, and then you can log out. So this is one more advantage, because up to 10 GB it is free, and it also involves a free account, also involves R and Python script support. And you can also create a web service. So these facilities are there. Okay. And okay, just a minute. Then after this, it will ask you for your Microsoft account. You can give your Microsoft account. It will ask you for your credentials. You can give your credentials, and then your account will get created. Okay. So these are the steps for creating the account. Your account will get created. And after this, it will take you to the sign-in page, and from your creds, you can sign in. And after signing in, it will take you to this area, which is basically experiment page, okay? And this experiment page, so this is an experiment page. I will be telling you, okay, so this is the page where all the experiments, we create all the experiments, okay? So I will be going through in this page also, and these are all the experiment listed experiments which I have created, all the latest ones, and you can create your experiments from here, and you can import your data sets also. I'll be showing you how you can import these data sets either from your hard drive or from some other website. You can do that, and then you can create a model. So how the model creation look like? Model creation looks like this. So I've created a very simple model for your demonstration, which is automobile price prediction. And this is a regression problem. And this is a very simple project which I have created. So I will be demonstrating you this also. So how I created this project. So before this, going into this canvas, we call this a canvas. This middle area is called as a canvas. this is a property area where you can see the properties related to all the functions which are there. And this is a functions area where you have all the functions listed down, like you are seeing save data set, trained models, transformation functions, all these functions. So it has a very rich functions library, not only for data cleaning, data profiling, but also for machine learning, data transformation, feature selection, and then deployment. And it has also support for R modules and Python modules. Recently, it is also having some deep learning library support, which is OpenCV. You can use it, and text analytics, basically, which is NLP. Okay, so these all supports are there, and freely you can use these, all the functions. So I will be telling you how you can use them. Now, just before going into a machine learning experiment, I am demonstrating you the typical life cycle of a machine learning project so that you can easily easily get a glimpse of what we will be doing. Okay, so this is a standard ML process, and this I am just revising. Most of you might be knowing this. People who don't know, they can just follow up. So this is a standard machine learning process, basically, where in you can see from the beginning, we have a raw data. Raw data can be in the CSV format. It can be in any format. And then what we do is we take this data to apply pre-processing. So we do some pre-processing on that data. And that pre-processing is having some 5-6 steps, or more than 5-6 steps, which involve removing the duplicate values, checking the data types of the data. So this is a pre-processing of the data. And then we have.
Sorry for disturbing. Have you made that annotation off from your end?
Just a minute, ma'am. I am just making it disable. Okay, I have done that. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you, sir. Continue.
Thank you, ma'am. So my screen is visible, right? This is screen. What is the standard ML process? This is visible.
Yes, sir. It's visible.
Okay. So this is a data apply pre-processing data step where you pre-process your data, and it is a it's very, 70% of our time goes in pre-processing of our data, right? Because we have to make our data very fit for the model. And most of the effort lies in data pre-processing. So I'll be telling you what are the steps of data pre-processing, what we do basically in data pre-processing. And then we have prepared data, which comes out from applying a pre-processing of data. So these are the steps, basically. Data preparation for analysis, you import and export your data. And then what you do is you summarize your data, you describe your data, you visualize your data, do then exploratory data analysis on that data, basically, which is also called as data profiling. And then what you do is you clean your data. So either you remove some columns based on some of your insights, you add some columns, you add some rows, you delete some rows, you see the data types, and you apply some filters, you clean the missing data. Missing data cleaning is very important. You select some columns which are important for your model. Some columns are definitely not important. Okay, but you always try to keep most data. So this is data cleaning. Then you did do some feature engineering, basically. Feature engineering is also part of data profiling or the data pre-processing, where you join data from various sources, you create some extra features like summation of two features, you make some of your categorical features into the numeric features. Like, for example, we have age, we have gender, which is male or female. So in order to make male and female into numeric, you do male for one and female for zero, and you, which is called as one hot encoding or encoding, basically. And then there is a data transformation or manipulation, where you transform your data into various types, you manipulate your data, then you select your features. So there is a feature selection module, which is there, which tells you that for which type of experiment or a problem you are solving, like, for example, regression or a classification problem, which features are important. So it's not necessary that out of 20 features or 50 features in your data, all features are equally important to your model. Okay. So first, just for the revision, I just want to give you an insight because there are students also. What we do in machine learning is basically we try and make the machine to learn what humans basically do. So for example, very simple example is prediction. So we try and make machine learn to predict. And how we do that is we basically train our machine for some sort of data. So let's say you have 1,000 rows of data and you train your machine, basically it's like a kid, training your kid based on experiences. And then for the new experiences, he automatically gives you the answers, right? So you train it, you train your model or your machine for around 800 rows for example. And then for the 200 rows, you test whether how much accurate is your machine giving you the prediction or the classification basically. And then it will be ready once you are satisfied with the accuracy. Like if your accuracy is coming very good, then you can basically for new type of data, you can apply that model and then you can predict basically. So this is basically a very simple demonstration for the people who are new to the machine learning. I'm just telling you. Then there is a deep learning also where you go into more complex areas. So all for creating this model so that it can predict accurately, we are doing this data profiling, we are doing data feature engineering, we are doing making the data fit for our model to learn accurately. Okay. So now principal component analysis is one more step where you basically do the dimensional reduction of your data basically. And then you have edit metadata. So these are all the steps which you require for your this one. Apply pre-processing of data. Then your data is prepared and then you apply a machine learning algorithm on that data basically. And then machine learning algorithms are basically divided into broadly two types. You will be studying them. One is supervised machine learning algorithm and the other one is unsupervised. So supervised basically means that you have basically classes. Basically you have the classes. Classes means like, for example, you know basically that it is cat or it is dog, and then you divide your data and train your model accordingly. Then it will classify that it is a dog or it is a cat basically. But unsupervised machine learning is basically where you don't know. Okay, you don't know. And then the model automatically figure out from the data that what will be the classes or what is the cluster basically and how will it go. So unsupervised learning is the one where the model as well as the people behind that model, they don't know much about the classes basically. Okay, so these are the two types of machine learning. And then there is reinforced learning, and then there are other kind of which we will not cover in this. So machine learning algorithms, basically I have a cheat sheet which will be very important for you for your interviews. So this is a cheat sheet basically given by Microsoft Azure, and you can see that I am just enhancing it. You can see these are the algorithms which are basically there. It is asked in interview, and it is also there helpful when you are building in model. Like anomaly detection, you have one class SVM, support vector machine is one algorithm. And then there is a PCA based anomaly detection. Okay, so for anomaly detection, basically anomaly detection is like out of 1,000, you detect 2% are outliers, are having some behavior which is not the correct behavior. Like for example, credit card fraud is an anomaly detection example. Then you have regression. Regression basically is ordinal, then you have poison, then you have fast forward, linear regression. These are all the regression, neural network. So in this, you have all, it is given like for which type of category you will apply which algorithm. Like for example, if you have data in the ranked order categories, it's very helpful. When you have data in the ranked order categories, you apply, it will be very good if you apply ordinal regression. Your results will be more improvised. When you are predicting the event counts, basically the probability, the event counts, then you apply Poisson regression. It will be very helpful because then accuracy will increase and it will predict the correct outcome. For predicting a distribution, if you have a distribution, you apply FAST forest quantile regression. And all these models, all these algorithms are there in our module of Azure, and they are just a click away. So you can see that in the these models, when I go machine learning area, in the initialized model, you have these categories, which are anomaly detection. For anomaly detection, you have one class support vector machine and PCA based anomaly, which I was discussing earlier. For regression, these are the models which they have given. You can, so, and just a click away. So what you have to do is just for, I will just demonstrate. You have to just, here is your data, and you have to just drag this model here in your canvas and attach it with your data. So this is very easy, no coding required. Just your model will be up and running. Okay, so this is as simple as that. Just what you have to just understand the processes, the steps which we will, which is required for a machine learning development. So if you understand all these steps, then it will be a very easy game for you. Okay, that's why I'm discussing these processes and how the flow will is, how, what is the flow for the machine learning process or the project, basically, so that you can catch up on. Okay, so these are all the algorithms which you can use for regression. When you are dealing with regression, if you are dealing with classification, then these are all the algorithms. And if you are focusing on accuracy, then what you should, what algorithm you should choose. If you are focusing on speed, what fast training, what algorithm you should choose, and all these things. Multi-class classification also, these are all. So all these algorithms are there for clustering. We have k-means clustering, and then how you can use these. So now I was there in this applying machine learning algorithm. So this is the stage of applying a machine learning algorithm. Then what we have is a candidate model. We create our model accordingly, apply machine learning algorithm, we create our model, and then we iterate to find the best fit model. So suppose we have three algorithms for a particular program, and then we want to see that what will be our final algorithm. Like, okay, so then you can choose between all these three, four, and no need to write various codes. You can do it simultaneously. So suppose you have these algorithms, 1, 2, 3, 4, one, two, three, four, and you want to choose between that which algorithm will give me the best results. Then what you can do is you can evaluate your model here in the we have a function which helps in evaluation of the model also, and then you can choose between them. So this, and then you deploy your chosen models. So suppose your best model is giving you the highest accuracy, then you deploy it. So I will tell you how to deploy this as a web service. And deployment is very important, because many times you create your model, you work on machine learning models, but you don't know how to deploy them. Then it will not be useful for the client or the end people or the person who wants to use it, because client will not be interested in your code, what code you have written in Python or what code you have written in R or any other language, Scala or any language you have written. He will not be interested in that. He will only be interested in the output, in the end product. And that, therefore, to create the end product, deployment of the model is important. What deployment means is, your model, once your model is ready, you make your model, you put your model on the cloud or on any other platform, so that, and make it such that your client can test on it and utilize on it. Either you can use the web service, you can make it a mobile app, or you can make it a desktop app or a web app or a website or a product. Okay, so this is, therefore, the deployment of model is important. And then you make your model into an application. So this is a typical process of a machine learning project. Okay, right from the scratch till the end. And you can also see this process same here in Microsoft Azure, where you have the data which is coming out from blobs and tables, Hadoop or a relational DB, it has this support. And then you harness this data, the data comes in the machine learning studio, which we will be working in. And then you create a, with the help of deployment, you create a web service and create an API out of this model. And then you can monetize this API, or this API can be used in the market space. I will also show you how you can put your project in the gallery, Microsoft Gallery, so that your teammates or your colleague or the your seniors or your faculty members or any other person or your client can easily see that project. Okay. And it is free, of course. Okay. It's like a portfolio, your portfolio. So the, and then you can utilize this data, the model or the results coming out of this model in terms of your mobile app, in terms of your desktop app on a tablet. So this is a, basically a typical machine learning life cycle. Okay. And these are various tools. I will go through them once. Okay. So this was a basic idea. Okay. And now, okay. So algorithm selection, where you choose your algorithm, algorithm cheat sheet. Okay. So now we are moving into hands-on. Okay. So if you have any questions up to now, up to this point, where we have covered up the theoretical part of the machine learning process, and if you have any question regarding this, you can shoot the questions, and if you give me a buzz, I can move ahead to for the demonstration. So any questions up to this point, you are having any question?
Sir, participants are muted from their side. If they have questions, then you can drop in the chat box.
Okay.
We will ask your question on your behalf.
Sure, sure, ma'am. So, okay. So, I'm moving ahead.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So, okay. Just, okay. Chat. Okay, so now we have some questions here. I can take some questions and then I can move ahead. One question is from Tushar. Sir, after deployment of model, will you tell us how you can use it effectively in an application? Simple one. Yes. So after deployment of the model, I will create a web service and I will show you how you can utilize the API of the web service, and as well as how you can utilize this web service. Okay. So I will tell you that, Tushar. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So this is the need of corporate, basically. So need of corporate is set up, you build, you deploy, and you share. And this technology which we are basically talking is called as machine learning as a service, which is MLaaS, which is very popular in corporate right now. It is MLaaS, which is cloud computing approach, which gives us a machine learning as a service, basically. And then why this area I have chosen, I'm just reiterating on it, because it is easy to build. It's easy to build, very easy to build, very easy to deploy. You can deploy it and it is very easy to share also. Okay. And then you have what I've already covered this, how you can build this. I have already covered this one also. And this is ease of use. So it is accessible to all. It has a massive scalability, where you can, 100 people can simultaneously work on it, more than 100 people, and you can deploy it in more than 1,000 machines as your capacity, because this is on cloud. So it has a massive scalability. It is computation powers is very high, because it's, again, it is computing on cloud. It's not dependent on your hard drive or your processor on your local machine. Okay, so you can basically, it has a very high computation power also, and it is very incredibly, it is low barrier to adoption, because just with the help of some clicks you can learn it, and it's not very difficult. Okay, it's very easy. And then you have some other players also, which you can explore: Google Prediction APIs, Google Colab, Google Prediction APIs. Then you can also go into check AWS ML, where there is a SageMaker, another. And then you can go with the Azure ML, which is today we will be talking about. Okay. And then, okay, this is basic coming. And then I will also be telling you some of the standard use cases where you have churn analysis and all these analyses are there. I will also showing one example of a deep learning API of Microsoft, created by Microsoft, which is a face recognition API. So after this hands-on, I will be telling you the face recognition API also. So now we are moving to hands-on. So for hands-on, first I told you how you can basically create your account in Microsoft Azure Machine Learning Studio. It is very simple to create the account. As soon as you will create the account and you will sign in, it will take you to this experiment page, and I will tell you how this experiment page looks like. So I'm just going to my experiments. You can go to my experiments here and just so this is a first page which you will be landing on. Right now I am getting these experiments, but as you will be the first user, so you will not be getting any experiment here. This will be your landing page. Then you can click on new in order to create a new experiment. So these are the columns. Basically this will be your repository, this will be your area, it will be dedicated to you, it will be telling you your name and the free workspace. Always there are paid workspaces also, but for, I will suggest you, for 10 GB of the data, you can always play around with the free workspace. And 10 GB is, I think it is good for some experimentation. Then this is a project area where you, whatever projects you will be creating, it will demonstrate your projects. You can create new project from here, click on new, and then it will be asking you for your empty project. You can create that. Okay, and then you can also create experiments. So how a project is different from experiment? Projects is basically collection of experiments. Okay, project is a bigger module, which is a collection of smaller modules like experiments. So there can be many experiments in one single project. So this is the difference between project and experiment. Okay, same you do in your software development. When you develop your software, there are some modules, there are modules, and there is one application. Okay, so project can be your one application. You build that project in the new, and then you have experiments here. How to create an experiment now? So just go to new, and from here it is giving you a blank experiment. When you will click on this blank experiment, it will take you to this page, which is a canvas page. And you can easily see, you can write the name of your experiment, like my test experiment. Okay, this will be your first experiment. Any name you want, any name you can write. Okay, and you can, this will be your name. And then this is a canvas basically. And this is a properties page, which will be related to the properties. Okay, this is a property page, and then you have this page, which is, you can minimize it also. Okay, and this is the page basically. Now just moving on. Okay, so this is an automobile price prediction experiment which I did, which is a very simple. So how, the next question is how you can import your data in this. Okay, so now if you see, we have our saved data sets. We have two in the left hand side. In the saved data sets, you have two categories. One is my data sets, and there is samples. Samples is like, they have a lot of data sets which are there, which is from Kaggle, which is from UCI library, which is from various other sources. So these are all the test data sets which are provided by Microsoft. You can work on these data sets. Okay, so how you can, so like for example, airports codes data set, I want to work on this, or automobile price data, raw data, I want to work on this. So what I will do is, I'll just click on this and drag this on this canvas. Okay, once I drag this on this canvas, my data set will be visible. And if you want to see, this is very simple. You don't have to write any code to import the data set. You just have to drag this data set here, and your data set will be available. Then right click on this and go to visualize. You can always download it also. You can visualize it. Once you go and visualize it, you will get a disk diagnose of this data. So this data is having 205 rows, it is having 26 columns, and for every column, 26 column, you can see what is inside these column. Okay, so like for example, symboling, this symboling is there, symboling column, and it will also show you how this data is distributed. When you click on this, it will show you how your data is distributed. So you can see that the mean of this is this, median is this, minimum is this, maximum value is this, standard deviation is this, for all these 205 rows. Unique values are 6 in this particular column, and you have missing value 0, no missing value, and the feature is numeric. Basically, the type of the data is numeric. Here, if you go in the bottom, you can see how it is distributed. So it is the frequency and the distribution. So symboling is basically distributed like this. Okay, and you can always compare it to some other column. I will tell you in order to find the correlation. You can also, there is a facility if you want to check the outliers. You can always click on this box plot and it will tell you how your data is distributed as per the block plot. So this is also a facility of this tool. Okay. So this is the diagnose. So normalized losses, if you see normalized losses column number 2, you can see it as having 41 missing values. So now for this normalized losses, it is very important to treat this missing values, because missing values always hamper our model. Okay, so it is telling you that the mean DN is this, mean is this, minimum is this, maximum is this, standard deviation is this. So this, all this exploratory data analysis of the data or the data profiling, you can easily do it here just with the help of click. Just right click, visualize, and you can do it. How this data is distributed, you can also see that. For fuel type, which is your categorical data, you can also see that it is having 2 unique values, whether the fuel type is of gas or it is of diesel. Your vehicle is of diesel or it is of... And then you can see that how it is distributed. So how many values are there in gas category and how many vehicles are there in your diesel category. It will tell you the elements and the percentage. So when you hover it, it will tell you out of these 205, 185 elements are, 90% elements are of gas, vehicles are of gas, and diesels are only 9.8%, which is 20 elements. This is very important. When you are checking on your data, any data you get, you import it here and you check what is inside in your data. Basically, do the diagnose of this data. Okay. So again, I am reiterating how I did it. I just go to the samples and, like, for example, bike rental data. I just drag it here. My data is available. Just right click on it and did this visualize option. So after doing this visualize, it will tell me how my data looks. Okay, instant, date, season, year, month, everything. Like, it is having 17,000 rows and 17 columns. Okay, so this is one way. You can delete it also. This is one way of playing with the data. The other way obviously is taking the data from your hard drive. Okay, so you are working on an experiment and you want some data from your hard drive, your data basically. How will you do it? It will come under my data sets. How will you do it? You go to this. Go to this data sets. Okay. Go to this data sets. These are all the data sets which I have been working. It will tell you that I have been working on the data sets. But since you are new, so you can click on this new. And in the new data set from the local file, it will ask from where you want to have this data, from my local file, and it will ask me for the choose file. So when I go to this choose file, it will give me it will take me to my hard drive, and in my hard drive I will can obviously select any data which I want to go with. So like for example, my DS projects, I have this NBA data, so I can choose this NBA data. And then it will give me a tick that this NBA data is there, existing data sets. It also asking me that in which format I want this data. So it is very good. I like this tool because you can have these many formats. You can also have a direct zip format data you can load here and unzip it. You can have a plain text data, SVM light data. Very, I mean, it gives you a facility, R object. So many data types you can have here. CSV file with a header, okay, no header, okay. So, and then you can write that bit data is your about this. And you can click on this right click, you can do a right click and your data will get uploaded here. So once your data gets uploaded, it's uploading my data. And you can upload it till 10 GB of the data, which is free of cost. And after 10 GB, it will ask you for some amount. Okay, then it will give me a message that upload of the data set NBA test has completed. Now my data is here. It will give me the name, by which name. If your friends also wants to upload, you are working on the same data, you can, then his name will also come like this. Okay, now it will give you the description. What is this data about? Data type and on which date you uploaded this data and from which or how much size this data is and the project name. You can delete also. If you don't want any data set, you can delete. Like for example, Walmart train, I don't want this. Any data I don't want, I can just click on this and I can go on delete and then I can delete it. Okay. Okay. So now, once this process is done, you go to again your experiment, which is there. Okay. And if you have created your experiment, automobile price prediction or any other experiment or new experiment, if you want to create, you can go to your new experiment here like this. Okay. And it will also show you the experiment which you have created. Okay. This experiment. And then in the my data sets, your data will come up. Like you, once you click on this my data sets, your data for this NBA test is there. You can see all your data sets are here. Okay, all your data sets are here. Just you drag this data set here in the NBA test in the canvas and your data is available to work. Just right click on this and visualize it. So you can easily upload the data from your hard drive into this machine learning studio platform and you can easily work on this. So this is rows, you have 458 rows, columns, you 9 columns are there and these are the players' names, your team in which they play, number, position, age, height of the player, weight of the player, college of the player, salary of the player. So this is basically the data which I was working on, NBA data, and I uploaded this data. Okay.
Vaibhav, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
Sir, there is a question from Tushar that how to allow friends to upload data sets.
Yeah, sure. So I will be telling you, how you can allow your friends also. So, okay. So if your friend is also having the account, so there is a option where you can give him this link and he will directly give him the, you can share with him this link and then he can directly access this. So it will be like a version control tool where you can directly so for example, when I publish my experiment in the gallery, so for example this is experiment is published in this gallery, automobile price prediction. So once you publish your experiment in gallery, then you can set who can see your experiment. So for example, here there are 1018 views and 921 downloads. So, and then when you click on this open in Studio Classic, it will take you to this link and then it will open the same experiment for you. And from this experiment, when it will get opened, you can play with this experiment and work on this experiment. Okay, this is one way where a person can work simultaneously with you. Okay. Other way would be So there are some authorization tokens, like for example, in settings where you go, there is a workspace name, then there are tokens. You can allow people for this workspace ID. Okay. You can allow people for this workspace ID by authorizing tokens. Like this is the primary users. So in users, it is giving you like right now, I am the only user. You can also allow some people here by this authorization tokens and then their name will also come. And then they can work on with you on this simultaneous experiments. There are some data gateways also. Okay. So this is another way. This is primary authorization token. Okay. So this is the way. default workspace, you give this. Right now, this is a free workspace. This is a workspace ID. You can give this. How much space is available? Like, for example, 7% of the 10 gigabytes right now is available with me. Okay, so this is all about your workspace, and you can give this authorization token, and then you can work. This is the second way, basically, where simultaneously people can work on these data sets. Okay, you can one more way is the same data set can be downloaded. Like, for example, when I click on this data set, NBA test, I can download it, and I can generate this data access code. Once I generate this data access code in Python or in R, this is the code snippet will get generated. Okay. And you can use this code snippet in your code. Okay. Directly. So you can see this workspace is there. Workspace ID is there, which is given. Authorization token is there, which is given. Endpoint is given, which is Studio. And once you use this code in Python or any other application or any other where you are working, then you can directly have this access to the this workspace, which is having this NBA test data. Okay, this is one more method. So there are 3-4 methods by which you can give the you can make other person work on this particular experiment or the particular data set. Okay, now there is one way I told you to diagnose this data, how you will diagnose this data. There is one more way where you can use one function to diagnose the data into more detail. So this is our NBA test data. I have already done this. Now you will go to stats module, or just you can either type in or go to this test module, which is there, statistical functions. And this statistical function, you have this summarize data function. You can just drag this summarize data function below this NBA test and connect this node with this node, which is your summarize data. And once your node gets connected, you go and run this. Just no need of writing the code. Just this function gets invoked once you drag it and you connect it. And then you can see here, you can see that your summarization data is being done. Just right click on it, results data set, visualize. Once you visualize it, it will give you more details about your data. For example, all the 9 rows, all the features, 23 features will be listed here. The name of the player, team of the player, number of the player, position of the player, age of the player, height of the player, everything will be listed here. And then you will be seeing the count. What's the count? Unique value count. How many unique values are there? Missing value count. How many missing values are there? Minimum values, maximum values, mean of the value, mean of the deviation, first quartile, mean, second. So all these statistical skewness, cutoffs, these are all the statistical functions. So no need to write individual code for finding out the statistical function of the data. Just you can select this summarize data, and you can drag it, and then you can connect with this data, and then you can utilize this summarize data to find out more about your data. Okay, so this is one more method. So just go through, let me quickly go through all the functions which are there, which can be useful for your experiment. And then I will again go to my this experiment of price prediction, and I will generate a model for prediction of the prices. And then I will show you how this model is working. Okay. So let us go through some more functions. Like, for example, in transformation module, in this data format conversion, you have these functions. Like, you, if your data is in particular format and you want to convert into a CSV format or a TSV format, you can just drag this function in the canvas, convert, connect your data set and convert it. Okay. Then we have a function which is data input and output. So if you want to enter your data manually, like we do it in our tables, you can do it. If you want to export your data, NBA test data. If you want to export somewhere, you can do that. You want to import your data from somewhere, like from UCI library or from some other workspace, you can import your data also. Like, for example, apart from the hard drive, this import data function give you, you just drag here in the canvas, this import data, and you can see this data source. So from this data source, like web URL HTTP, when you click on this web URL HTTP, you can write this data source URL. Like, for example, Kaggle dataset URL or any other dataset URL, you can just type the URL here and define the format for the data, and then you can directly import this data. The data will come directly. Okay. So this is one more function. An unpack zip datasets. Unpack zip dataset. If you want, you have zipped dataset, you want to unpack them, you can just connect your zipped dataset with this unpack zip datasets and just run on selected. When you run on this selected or run, your datasets will get unzipped and then you can download it. Okay, this is one more way. Now, data transformation. So data transformation, these filters are there, these functions are there, which are filters, various filters are there, median filter. Then they are learning with counts, how many counts you calculate, manipulation. In manipulation, you have adding the rows, subtracting of the rows, applying SQL transformation. You can also apply SQL script on your data. Okay, you can apply SQL transformations on your data. This is also one more flexibility of this tool. You can clean your missing data. You can convert to your indicator values. You can edit metadata, group categorical values. Same you do in Excel, you do grouping, you do joining. You can remove your duplicate rows. All these functions are there which you can use. Then there is a sample and a split, where you want to sample your data, partition your data, and then scale and reduce. You want to clip values. Okay, so all these functions are normalize your data. If you want to normalize your data, you can also normalize. Once you drag it, then you connect your data set with this normalize, and it will ask you that what is the normalization method. If you want in z-score normalization, or you want minimum maximum normalization, all these normalization methods are there when you can normalize your data. It is very helpful. Okay, then you do a principal component analysis. You just drag this, connect your data here, and it will ask you that number of dimensions you want, for which column you want to do PCA. You want to do this, and you can do this. So these are all the facilities which are provided under this tool, which is very good for learning. Then there is a feature selection, where you can select the most important features of your data by just these three methods. You can use LDA method or permutation feature importance, or okay, you can just drag them and use them. Then you have machine learning and all these steps. You can use Python script also. How you can use Python script? Just click on this execute Python script, and you can connect your data here. This editor will get opened up. You just go to this and write your Python script here. Same you write in your Jupyter, or same you write in your Spider or any other IDE. You can write your Python script here. And after this, writing your Python script, connecting with your data, you can just go and run it so that your Python script on this data will get executed. One more facility is there. Parallelly, you can have many operations. Like, this data set can be converted to many functions parallelly, and simultaneously many operations can be carried out. So like, you can see in one branch, I am doing this Python script. In one branch, I am doing the summarization of data. For one branch, I can do normalization. For one branch, I can do execute this R script also, connect my data with this. So parallelly, you can do many operations on your data and see this results. Okay, so that's why this tool is good. It's flexible, it's good. Okay, then you have statistical operations, where you can basically apply math operation. Any math operation, if you have some numeric data, you want to apply some math operation, you can do this. A mathematical function, basically. You can compute elementary statistics. Apart from summarization of data, this is one more way. You can just drag it, connect your with this, and run this. So parallelly, you can compute elementary statistics also. So when I go and run on it, this function will get executed. Okay, so when I'm running it, okay, everything is going on cloud. Nothing is related to your hard drive. So once you click, that's why it is very fast also. Once you click on this compute elementary statistics, you go to results data set and visualize. This is your computation of elementary statistics will be there, where there is a deviation of a squared number or of a deviation of squared age. How much deviation is there? How much deviation is there for weight? How much deviation is there for salary? So this will be there. Okay. Then what you can do is there are other functions also, like, for example, summarization of the data, replace your discrete values, evaluate probability function, compute linear correlation. So, for example, you want to compute correlation between two features. Correlation is basically the dependence of one factor feature on the other feature, your column basically. So once you click on this compute linear correlation and just run this, it will compute a linear correlation for you for various numerical features. Okay, so it's calculating. So now you can go here and visualize it. Once you go and visualize it, it will give you this 9 columns, 9 rows, and it is giving you this correlation basically. Right now it is not coming. Nothing is correlated, so that's why it is giving you nan means nothing, zero. Okay, so same way you can compute linear correlation. Then what you can do is time series analysis, text analysis, and time series analysis are all the way different. They work for different set of data. So all the major functions I have explained to you. Now I am going back to my experiment, and I will demonstrating how you can create a regression on this canvas, on this machine learning studio. So here, this is my experiment, which is my automobile price prediction. And in this automobile price prediction, I'm trying to predict the prices of my vehicles. I have this data. I'm just making it more bigger, zooming in. So this is my automobile price data, and I have connected. So this is my data, and let me check what is inside my data. So when I'll check it, I'll go to the data set and I'll visualize. So it will give me what is inside my data. So you can see that my data set is having 205 rows and 26 columns. And this, all these columns are there: drive, wheels, engine, location, body style, number of doors, all these vehicle base, length, width, height, cut weight, everything is there related to horsepower, automobile, my automobile. And then there's a price. So this price is my variable, predicted variable, where I will be predicting the price of some of my automobiles. Okay, so right now it is there. And my aim is to predict for similar set of values, which I'll get in future. My model should be able to predict the price accurately. This is my aim. Okay, so you can see that this is my independent or a variable which is predicted variable. Okay, then what I can do is, this is my first step, where I got my data here and I checked on my data and everything I did. Then second step is to select columns in the data set. Now I don't want all my columns to go into the model. Okay, I want some important columns only, which are basically very much important for the model prediction, should go into the model. So what I did for this, I did this select columns in data set. So how you can do it? You can just go to this type select, and you will have this listed function, select columns in data set. Just drag this function here, select column in data set, and just connect it with this data set. Okay, and your work will be done. In Python and R, when you are doing this experiment, you'll have to write a code for importing your, first you have to write a code for importing the pandas or a NumPy or these libraries, similarly in R. And then what you'll have to do is you'll have to write a code to import your CSV file or raw data file. And then you have to write code to select the columns in the data set. Okay, suddenly in this, you just have to drag and drop. Then the next step, so how I can do it, here is the properties window for every function. Okay, for every function, there is a property window. It tells you what you have to do. So launch column selector, you go on launch column selector. And launch column selector by name, these are all the selected columns. So out of all the 26 columns, right now I have selected 25 columns. How you can do it? Just click on the symboling. The symboling will come here. Okay. And just symboling, you, if you want to select, you can select. So all available columns will be listed down here. And all selected columns will be listed down here. This is very simple. Okay. Okay. So just select your columns. With rules also you can select. You can just include column names. All the, you can write your columns name. It will come here. And with name also you can do it. Okay, just drag and drop your column name. So all these 25 columns are right now selected. Okay, I have selected these 25 columns right now. I want to do something on this. I have selected them. And then I will do next operation is clean missing data. So from my very first hinge, when I saw this, I got to know that some of my columns are having missing values. Okay. And I have to treat them. So for example, normalized losses were some, they were having some missing values. So what I did was I applied this clean missing data function. After selection of columns, I applied this clean missing data function. And how you can access this function is just type in clean. So you'll get this clean missing data. Just drag it here. Clean missing data, and you can connect it. Okay, so this is very handy. You can just, with the help of drag, you can just go and use this clean missing data. Connect your data set, which is coming out of this 25 rows. So you can also visualize this. Right now it is not invoking because you have not run it. After selection, run it. Okay, run. When you run selected is basically for selected function running, and run is for all. So it will run all of your experiment in one go. Once you run it, green tick will come. Okay. Then you go to results data set. You need to see that only 25 columns are there instead of 26 because you have selected only 25. You have removed one column, which is normalized losses, which was coming here. You have removed it. Now clean missing data in launch column selector, it will ask you for which column you want to clean your missing data. You want to select a column or you want to go for all the columns. Launch column selector basically helps you to select. So I want to apply this clean missing data function on all my columns. So that's why I've selected all columns. Okay. All columns selected. And then it will ask you like, you want to remove the entire row, or you want to replace it with some mean, or you want to replace it with some median, or you want to replace it with some mode. So these are the good functionalities which are given. So for clean missing data, wherever there is a value which is missing, it will obviously either put mean of all the rows of all that particular column, or it will. So this is up to you what you select. Here I'm selecting remove the entire, I'm removing all the rows, right? I'm removing all the rows. So someone has raised their hand. Okay, just a minute. I'm going to chat. Okay. Just a minute. Chat. Okay. How to allow, okay. So I'm not able to see the question.
Sorry to interrupt you, sir. There are no questions in the chat box. We have already discussed the further questions.
Okay, okay. So I saw someone raising the hand. So that's why I got... okay. Okay, no issues. So clean missing data, basically, up till now it is clear. Any issues, any problems with the flow which we are going in? I think you might have done these steps when you were working on your machine learning project or machine learning experiment, or else if you have not done it, then there is no issue. It is very simple. These steps are followed universally. Like, you import your data, whichever data you want to work, then you carefully view your data, that which is your predicted column, which is your number of categorical variables, number of numerical variables. You do that, and then you select that out of, you can choose all the columns also here. I can remove this select columns and data set. You can choose all the 26 columns and remove the missing values of that. It's up to you. Here I'm just trying to experiment, I mean, give you a gist of how we can do some tasks and do some things on here. Okay, so clean missing data, you clean your missing data, just run it. Okay, and it is, these steps are usually followed, like you clean your missing data, you remove your duplicate rows, then you divide your data into test and train. Okay, so now this clean missing data functionality is done. You can go and right click on this. You will have this cleaned data set, and clean data set, you will visualize it. Definitely you will have the, see, you can see this earlier, there were 205 rows. Some more rows were there. Now these rows have reduced to 193, which means that your rows which were having missing data, they got removed because you choose to remove them. When you click on this, you will, now you will see there are no missing. Missing values will be zero. In each and every column, there will be no missing values because you have removed these missing values. Okay, so you have done the treatment for missing values. Okay, no missing values. 193 rows, 25 columns. Earlier, there were 205 rows, something like that. Okay. Okay. This time. Then, again, I am selecting some of my columns in the data set, select columns in the data set. I want my model to work on some more relevant features. So I have selected.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Sir, there is a question raised by Sudhanshu.
Yeah.
Can any error occur in this process? Can any error come in this process?
Yes, error can come. And you have the error log also. Like, for example, errors are usually, if you don't choose it correctly, if you don't, so clean missing data, I think up till now there can be no errors, but let's say errors can be there, and then you, but don't need to worry. When there is an error, there is a log which gets generated, and it tells you that which error is there and how you can resolve it. So there is an error log also. I will tell you in detail how you can resolve, how you can go about it. So for every function, as you have asked me, I am just telling you, for every function, whenever you click on this function, there is a quick help. Okay, this is very, very helpful. Quick help. When you click on, so it gives you a description of this particular function, like select columns in data set. What it does is it selects columns to include or exclude from a data set in operation formally known as project columns. Okay. And then if you want to dig deeper, you want to know more, then you can click on this more help. When you click on this more help, it will take you to the documentation. And the documentation is very, very rich. For every function, for every step which we do, there is a documentation. And this documentation helps you, like model overview, how you can utilize this particular function. It gives you how you use select columns and data set, for which type, how everything will be there. Okay, with rules, how you can do it. And there are examples also. If you click on examples, it will take you to the examples where you can learn from the examples and choose by type, then choose by index and the errors related to the particular. So these are all the examples where they have used this particular select columns in a data set function, breast cancer detection, flight delay prediction, and how they are using it, you can learn here. And then there are common scenarios for column selection where I want to remove text. Everything is there. You can go in detail and you can learn. It is also helpful for you in your machine learning project creation because this documentation will give you this is a very informative. You can apply whether you are coding in Python or R, these steps will always be there. Okay. Sure. So this is a code also which gets generated in R. If you want to remove some data set, this is a code in R. Execute R script also. Yes, ma'am.
Excuse me, sir. There is a question by Ankit.
Yeah.
If I have a data of COVID-19 cases in the world till now, and I want to count total cases till 20th April separately, country-wise. Can I do this?
Yes, you can do this. Why not? You can do this. Okay, so if you have data for COVID-19, okay, so I think I have worked on one COVID-19 problem recently. I can tell you, okay, so how you can do it. Okay, so just a minute. Let me complete this one. So here are the errors and exceptions, which are, so you can see here that if an exception occurs, one or more specified columns of the, so let's say there can be one error where you are selecting one column, but it is not there. So this can be error 001. An error 003 would be an exception occurs if one or more input data sets are null or empty. So for example, you are trying to do a missing value on one column, but it is having no values. It is just empty. Then these errors can occur. And when these errors can occur, they will give you the exception ka code. And when you go to this error, they will also give you how to, you can remove this error. Okay, so this is very good. So, okay, so this is, errors can also be there, but this is the way you can go and fetch out the errors and remove the errors. For every module, you will have this rich documentation. Okay, so I hope I answer your question. Now, the question is related to COVID-19. So recently, I have worked on one project, which was a COVID-19 project. Let me give you a gist of that. And okay, this was my, okay, and I have this COVID-19 data with me, which is this one, COVID-19. And what I will do is, now I will import the data here in my Azure machine learning experiment for you. Okay, so what I'll do is, I am just removing this. I will go to this data set. Okay, and in the data set, I will click on new. I will upload from my local. I will choose file. I will give the path of my hard drive. This is my COVID-19 data. It is in CSV format. Okay, comma separated values. Once I click on this, okay. It is loading this data, COVID-19 data. Okay. It will take some time because the data is a little bit heavy. Based on your broadband connection and number of instances of the machine learning studio you have opened. Okay, so you can see that this is a large data which was having, okay, right now it is 2.28 MB, it's not that large. And it got, okay, compared to this one, it was some bit bigger, 2.82 MB. And it got loaded here in my COVID-19, in my data sets. Okay, and it was a generic CSV, it was submitted by me. Now I want to utilize this data. As you are seeing the count, how can I see the count, okay? So what I will go do is, I'll go to my experiment, and either I can create a new experiment, but my this experiment is created today, which is there. I will go to the same experiment, or I, okay, NBA test. I will remove this NBA. I don't want right now this NBA. But I just click and delete. And in my saved data sets, I will have this COVID-19 data CSV. So I will just drag it. For use, it will be useful. Now, once I drag it, I will right click on this and I will go and visualize it. Once you go and visualize it, you will get that you have 43 rows, 721 columns, almost 50,000 rows of this. 8 columns are there, which is observation date, on which date the patient was observed. And then the province, this is Beijing. Country region is also there. So I have India also here, mainland China, last update, when it was last updated. Then I have confirmed deaths and recovered cases. Okay, so I can count this confirmed cases death cases and recovered cases. So you want confirmed cases. Okay. So once I click on this confirmed cases, you will get basic statistics of this confirmed cases, like how many cases are confirmed. But your question is like for a particular country, if you want to check. Okay, so you can check. US, you have 6614 cases. In mainland China, you have 4555 cases, which are total confirmed deaths and recovered total cases. And in Canada, you have these cases, and in Japan, and similarly, these cases are there. But you want more, you want specific diagnosis. So what you can do is you can apply some filter here. Right, you can apply some filter, or you can select the columns. Okay, so you can apply a filter, which is obviously in data transformation, you will get these filters. Okay, apply filter. And on country, you can apply this filter. And with learning with counts, you can build a counting transfer, build export, import counting, merge count. You can do this build counting transform. Okay, so applying this filter here, you can connect your data with this, and you can launch your column, apply filter on which country, for example, you want to apply your filter. You can apply this filter here. Okay, country, region, recovered. I don't want death. I want confirmed. Okay, cases. Okay, and then you can. So once you apply this filter, import filter is unconnected. So which filter it is? It, median filter, moving, user defined filter. Okay, you connect this filter with this user defined filter, and this user defined filter, you select which FIR or IR you want, and you run it. There can be several ways of doing this. There can be several ways. You can write a Python script also. You can write a R script also. You can write there can be several ways of doing this. In statistical transformations also, so it's giving me one error here. Okay, so might have done something wrong. It's giving me some error, which is hey, how you can go out this error also. It is saying that column name with country is a not allowed category. Okay, so it is not allowed category. Okay, so I can select some other category here. Okay, so there can be several ways. Like for example, right now I'm only selecting confirmed. Okay, and then I'm running it. It depends on data is numeric, it depends on data, if your data is categorical or which type of data is there. Okay, now it has run. Now you can go to results data set and visualize it. It will give you confirmed cases, this category it will give you of the confirmed cases. So this is a filter, I have selected only this one. I can select some other category also in user defined filter. If I go with IIR, backward and forward. So this can be, so once you go to quick help, more help, it will give you how to utilize these filters and how to work on this data. I can do one way also, I can connect one statistical function here, which will give me a descriptive analysis of particular each and every row. Okay, so I can go to this statistical functions where I can summarize my data. And once I summarize my data and apply this run selected, it will give me the summarization according to all the columns. Here also you can do it. So in this way, you can basically count, and you can also connect your live stream data here by the URL. So it is giving you this. So you can see this observation date, country. So country, you go in the country, you will see what are the values of the country, particular values of the country, minimum, maximum values, and all these values. Okay. Can you explain comparison between AWS, E2, and Azure? What is the pandas for data? What if I use? You can use pandas for data processing. You can use pandas here also, connecting it with the Python script for data pre-processing. And in Jupyter, you can do it with the pandas. But it depends. If you want to code away, you can go and code on Python, Jupyter, or in any other. But if you want to, if you don't like coding and do it, then you can use this tool basically. And you can, in this tool also, what you can do is there is a feature of using Python script. So you can always use a Python script and code. Okay, so there is also the feature. Okay, so count total test cases till 20th April separately country wise. So you can do this with these steps. I have demonstrated. Okay. You can apply a filter and use this filter for this COVID-19 data set. Okay. Or you can write code also. So for example, this Python script, I execute this Python script here. Okay. And my data set gets connected to this Python script. And I can probably write a script for this import pandas data frame. Okay. And then I can write the script here and I can use my script to count the number of cases. Or what another way would be using an SQL transformation. There is an SQL transformation also. You can connect your data here with this and you can write your query. Select a star from T1. Similarly, select a star from your table T1 where you can fetch out count of confirmed cases based on country. So you can write a query, SQL query here, and your query will work on this data very fine. And you can fetch out the number of cases. So these are the 4-5 steps which I have demonstrated where you can solve your problem. And you have this COVID-19 data set. I hope it is clear. Okay. Thank you. Okay. So, and I will always compare. So if I have some time, I will definitely compare EC2 with this. Let me complete my experiment first. And then in later stages, I can compare. I have a comparative study also of AWS and Microsoft Azure, which I did a couple of months back, but the time will be short. So let me see if I have some time, I will focus on that also. So, okay. So now this cleaning missing data is there. Select columns in the data sets. Now I am selecting only very few for the demonstration purpose. I am selecting here so that my model can run fast. I am selecting out of these 25 columns. I selected only make, body style, wheelbase, engine base, size, horsepower, peak RPM, highway, MPG, price. These I have selected. Only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, and when I select this, I will run selected, and you can see out of these 25 columns, I will get only selected columns in my this data sets. Okay, so now my data set, I have reduced it to 8 columns and 193 rows. Instead of 25 columns and 193 rows, I reduced it. Okay, so only important features are there. Only price is obviously important. It is independent. It is the predicted one. And the apart from price, these are the important. Make, body style, wheelbase, engine size. These are the important. Now, after doing this, the standard step is to split my data. Okay. So there is no need to write the code for splitting the data. You have to split. Why you split your data? Because some part of data you want your model to run. And some part of the data you want your model to test, basically. In corporate, basically, we divide into 3 parts. One is test, other one is train, another one is split, validate. Train, validate, and split, basically, test. Okay. So now here, but I am doing into 2 parts. One is, for splitting of the data, I am applying this split data function, which you can get from here, split. When you type split, you will get this under data transformation sample and split, you will get this split data function. You drag this split data here and connect your selected columns in the data set to this one, and you will directly, it will get invoked. And then how you want to split your data will depend on the type of mode, splitting mode. So you want to split your data based on rows, or you want to split your data based on some regular expression. You want to split your data based on relative expression. You can do that also. And recommender split is for recommendation engines. So we are not talking about that. There is a separate module for how to build recommendation engines using Microsoft Azure. So this is for that. So split rows, I'm selecting split rows. 0.75 is the amount. So let's say 75% and 25%. So I want my 75% data to go into training of the model, and 25% data I want that it should go into testing of the model. Okay. You can change this also. You can do it 70-30 also. You can do it 60-40 also. You can change it based on your and then randomized split I am choosing. So there are two types of splits. One is randomized split. The other one is stratified split. Randomized split is basically when your order is not defined. Basically, for example, from 1 to 1000, you are dividing your data in any random order. And stratified is like from 0, 1 to 1000, first 1 to 800 or 700, 750 should be in train, and other 751 to 1000 should be in test. So randomized split is always recommended. Random seed, you can do it 0 or you can do it 1, 2, 3. It is always setting the path for your splitting. And then stratified split, you do false. These steps you follow for splitting of the data and you run it. So once you run your selected function, then your data will get splitted into two parts. One part would be having 75% of the rows. The other part would be having 25% of the rows. So you can see result data one, data set one will have your trained data. It will have 75% data and the other will have 25. You can see 145 rows, which is exact 75% of 193 rows. You will have this 145 rows here in your result data set one, which is your train one, and the other result data set two, which is your when you visualize, it will be having 48 rows that you will be using for your train model. Okay, then now everything is done. Now we will move to model creation. How you can create a model out of this data? It's very important. One is to select. Step one is to select which model you will apply. So right now I want to apply linear regression. Very simple. For how you can choose this, you can go to this machine learning area, machine learning module. Machine learning module, there are initialized module regression. These are the number of algorithms you can use for your training of the data. Right now I have selected linear regression. Just drag and drop here. I can select any other module also. Algorithm also, and I can, or I will also show you how you can choose multiple regression or classification algorithms for the same data set and compare between the two. Okay, this is called as the cross validation. So linear regression I have chosen. One part of your split data will go to this one train model, and for training of the model you have selected this algorithm. Now for training of the model, you have to select the train model. So train model function is, you will find train model function here, which is, don't worry. And 2-3, when you do 2-3 experiment, you will learn these steps and then it will be very handy for you. So in first, I am sure you will be getting some issues, but when you, so these are the standard steps. So once you do through 2-3 experiments, you will learn this. So train model is, so for every lean regression or classification model, you have a train model function, which helps you to train your model based on this algorithm and based on your data set. So train data set will go in one node, one input, and your model information will go in this train model function, and it will churn it for you. So this is your train model. For recommendation engines, we have separate. For clustering, we have separate. For anomaly detection, we have separate. So for normal regression and classification, you have train model. Just copy, just drag it here in the train model and just connect one part of your algorithm to this one. The green light will obviously get invoked. So you have to connect your node to the green light only. Split one will be connected to this one. Okay, when you connect it, same way this gets connected, and then run it for scoring. Now the training is being done. Now you can run this selected So your model, linear regression model, will apply here. Your model will get trained according to linear regression algorithm on your trained data, which is 75% of your data. It's training. It got trained. You can see within 10 seconds, your model got trained within 10 seconds. Now it's time to see the values, the predicted values. So one part of this trained model will go to score model is basically showing the predicted values. Okay. How you can show the predicted values, which is scoring of the model. Okay. Don't get confused with the name. Scoring doesn't mean the finding out the accuracy of the model. Scoring here means finding out the predicted value of the test data. Okay. So one part of this split, which is the test one, it will get connected to the score model. Other part of the trained, which is coming here, will get connected to the score model. And you will run this selected. Once you run this selected, what will happen is your test data set will have the predicted values. Your test data set will have the predicted values so that you can compare how your model got performed. Go to this, right click on it, go to visualize. Once you go to visualize, you can see that your 48 columns, which are your test data set, and you will have these values. Score levels are your predicted values. So you can see your original price of this particular vehicle, particular model was $11,259. It has predicted that the price would be $10,286. For this particular model, which was Mitsubishi, your price was $6,669, but it has predicted your price $5,446. Okay, now for this model, your price was $6,223. It has predicted it $6,344. Now these are all the predicted values. If you want to check what's the accuracy of my model, you can definitely use this evaluate model function, which is useful for predicting the accuracy of the model. Connect it with your score model and run it. Once you run this evaluate model, it's just running. You will get all the accuracy matrices which are useful for the model, checking the model accuracy. Go to evaluation results and visualize. Once you go, you can see the MAE, the mean absolute error is this. Root mean squared error is this. Relative absolute error is this. Relative squared error is this. And you are getting coefficient of determination is 0.91. You can also see that your model is 91% accurate on this data, test data, right? On this data, 91% accurate. And this here, you can see the errors also. So in this way, you can evaluate your model. Okay, so how your model is performing on the test data. If you want to use, now there are two questions. First question is, I have trained this model and now I want to use I will take some questions now. How did you tell model that it should predict price, not horsepower or anything else? Yes, Tushar, when I chose this one, trained model, when I use this trained model function, here in the launch column selector, it asks me that for which particular column I want to predict. Okay. So I can choose from here the list of columns. I can choose my price, which is my independent column or my predicted column to be the selected. I can also choose horsepower here if you want to train your model on horsepower and predict the horsepower. You can also do that. Just remove this price and choose the horsepower. So your model will get trained on horsepower, right? It will predict the horsepower, right? And you can do the same way. Okay. So here I am choosing price. You can also do with the horsepower or any other numerical feature you want. I hope it is clear now. only one can be, no, see, for multi-class regression classification problems, there can be more than one independent variables. In case of, I think, multi-class regression also, there can be more than one variable. So I think you got what I'm saying. So this is just a simple demonstration. There are complex experiments also which you can perform using this tool. So evaluate model. So now one more thing I want to demonstrate. Let's say I am not satisfied with my linear regression. My accuracy is coming. In linear regression also you can choose, like, you want an ordinary least square or you want only gradient descent. Okay, and you can also choose. So this is hyperparameter tuning, which we call in our corporate world, where you tune your model, the hyperparameters of your model, basically. So let's, here I am choosing online gradient descent. I am choosing ordinary least squares for my linear regression training. And regularization weight also, I can increase, decrease the regularization. Randomness. If you want to know more on this linear regression, obviously go to this quick help. In the quick help, you will get everything related to linear regression and how you can use it, how you can do the hyperparameter tuning. See, tune model, hyperparameters, everything would be there. Everything, okay. Okay, so now I'm not satisfied with this linear regression. I want to train this model with the use of neural network or some other thing. So what you can do, just delete here. Only one node you have to delete. Go to machine learning here. There are regression modules, boosted decision tree, which is like random forests, neural network regression. Just choose this neural network. So that's why I first showed you the sheet where you can choose for which type of data and which type of problem you can choose which algorithm. So to get fast result or to get more accuracy, basically. Okay, so this is the way. Long training time, it takes long training time, but it gives more accuracy. Neural network regression. Okay, so I am choosing neural network regression. What I did was I just dragged and drop here neural network regression. I'll just connect it with my train model and I'll run my experiment again. I'll run it again. So instead of linear regression, now you are training your model on neural networks. Okay, let's see how much is the accuracy which comes out by using neural network regression. You can see within fraction of seconds, your model is on the neural network, it got trained. Okay, scoring is being done. Now evaluation is being done. Okay, so, okay, now it got. So evaluation is done. Now you can right click on this, go to evaluation results, and you can check whether your accuracy increased or decreased. So you can see that your root mean squared, your accuracy is highly, it got decreased by this, and it is not the right fit. So relative absolute error, you got this. Relative squared error, you got this. Root mean squared error, you got this. So I think this is, neural network is not the right fit for this. So you can choose any other also. Score model also, you will get some results. Like if you visualize it, you'll get this results, score levels, like you can see why this also you are getting this thing. Or what I should do is so let's say I had multiple, if I want to use multiple at the same time, multiple algorithms. So how I can use, so I will put my linear regression back here. And let's say I want to use neural network or some sort of decision, boosted decision tree. So I will drag this one here. And and I will also, what I will do is I should have one train model, this one function along with my model algorithm. So one part of this will go to Same, one part of this will go here and it will tell you the data set you want to use. So this one part of the split data will be here, okay? And then same, you have a score model you put here. Score model, your one part of the score model will be having from here. It will, and this split data will definitely go here. Okay, train model, it's asking me that which variable I should be. So I want to have it for price, so I can have it for price. Okay, and then again, evaluate model. So I can connect this evaluate model, score model here with my evaluate model. Okay, so now I am comparing two models. One is my boosted decision tree and the other one is my linear regression, which you can see, and I will run this experiment again. No complexity of writing codes. Obviously now you can have, there are some AutoML libraries in Python, PyCaret or some sort of these where you can do these steps also. You can simultaneously know which model will be suitable for your data. It will give you the accuracy, the root mean square error in just one line of code. But earlier in Python, we used to write for every algorithm, we used to write codes and then you used to check the scoring of every model. So evaluation model, you can go and visualize this. And you can see the comparison of these two models. So you can see that your boosted decision tree, which is some sort of random forest, gave you some more accuracy, gave you 1 point more. So 92% accuracy it gave you. Accuracy increased from your linear regression and it gave you an accuracy of 92% on the data. So in this way, you can check more. Also, you can attach any number of algorithms and you can check which algorithm is giving you the high accuracy and you can work accordingly. Obviously, accuracy increasing factors are more. I can talk in detail, like there are numerous steps which are required for accuracy, increasing accuracy, like feature engineering should be good, selection of features should be good, more, there are a lot of things which are there. It's okay. So I, because of time constraint, I am not taking that. It is very detailed thing. Now, okay, so now just last, so I hope this is done. You are following this, you understand this. Any question on this I can take, and then I will go to the last step where I can develop a web service of this model. And I will show you how you can utilize the web service, or your client can utilize the web service, or your faculty members can utilize the web service for their. So this is the last step I will go, and I will also show you how you can deploy this model in the published to gallery. You can publish this model in gallery and you can set up a web service out of this model. So this is the last step of this experiment and algorithm for today, which I will be doing in front of you. Apart from this, one more is the phase detection API, which I think the time permits, I can do that. So if you are clear with this, I can move ahead. Just give me a buzz. If any questions are there, I can take them, or else I can move quickly ahead. Any questions? No questions? I can move. Okay, thank you. So now I want to create a web service of this experiment. I have chosen that you can type your question in the chat, Deepak. I will take from there. Okay. So I have decided, let's say that my this boosted decision tree, I want to go with this algorithm. So what I'll do is I'll remove this particular algorithm, which is this one. Okay. And okay, so now this is my chosen algorithm. Okay, this is my chosen algorithm. It is giving me error because I have wrong node I have selected. Now I will run this experiment when I chose that I will go with the boosted decision trees regression. Okay, and after running of this experiment, what I will do is I will set up, go to the setup web service, and I will create a predictive web service recommended. Okay. It will create a predictive experiment for me from a training experiment. You can see that it has created from this training experiment. It has created now in the message also, it is showing that I am creating a predictive experiment. It has created this. You can go to details also. You can, in the detail, it will show you found a train module in training experiment, created trained X model from created predictive experiment. So it has this is my training experiment. It created the predictive experiment. Difference between training and predictive experiment is, you can see that when I do this, when I maximize it, you can see that it is giving web service input node. It has created one input node, an input entry, where I will be entering my inputs. The client will be entering his inputs from the new data, and there would be one output node where you will be receiving one output. Okay, so this is a predictive experiment. Now it is, now you can give one input here, values, and then you will get a predicted values of the new data. After doing this, you run your predictive experiment. You run your predictive experiment, it gets converted to, gets ready for the web service. Just with the help of drag and, I mean, just with simple clicks, you are converting your experiment into a deployable experiment. Otherwise, you'll have to write a code. So nowadays in Python, what we are doing is we create a Flask API or a Django API or a Heroku, and then we create a model, and in the model, we make it a deployable or an app, and then we, with the help of Flask, with the help of coding in Flask or coding in the other platforms like Heroku and Django, we deploy our model on the app or on a website. So we have to write some codes for the creation of the Flask app around that. So now your this productive experiment got run, and after this you go to this deploy web service. So once you go to this deploy web service, your web service will get deployed. And then I will show you how you can consume this. So you can see here, your on cloud, your automobile price prediction predictive experiment is deployed. And here you can see the API related to this particular web service. You can use this API in your code, similar like a Twitter API or any other API you use. You can use this API. You can also consume here. You can test your web service here. Like, you can click on your test enter any data you want to predict. So like, for example, from my any data, I will write the symboling value of the normalized losses of my vehicle, make of my vehicle, fuel type of my vehicle, aspiration of my vehicle. All these things I will write. And when I click on this right click, I will get the price, predicted price of the particular vehicle. So this is my app. This is my product. This is my deployable web service. Here is the app. This is a simple form. Your client can write these. Obviously, you can limit these values also. So you can just write these values, and your client will get the price, predicted price of the particular vehicle he want to know. One way is this of testing this. Other way of testing is with the Excel. If you will click on this Excel 2010 or later, or Excel 2013 or later, when you click on this, it will create an Excel web service for you. This is the Excel downloadable web service. Just click on this, and when you click open this Excel downloadable web service, obviously you have to invoke macros. Go to enable editing and turn on this add-in. Okay. Restart. Okay, I don't know. I might be one my because of some security issues or because my macro, I have not enabled macros because of some security issues. That's why it is giving me some errors related to this. Okay, let me choose something like this. But you guys can try it. This will be, I will try once more. Give me, okay. Let me try 2013 or later. I have this 2010 or later. So I have this 2010 or earlier version. Let me try with this. Okay. So it will give you an Excel downloadable version also. So you can utilize this for your web service, I mean for your product. And I'm also going to the dashboard. It will create a dashboard for you where you can basically, so this is the one I suppose, enable editing. Sorry, I choose something else. Okay. It will give you the web service URL. You can directly give this URL to someone. And he can access this. So for example, if your friend want to do this and give this URL to him, just copy this URL and give him this URL. When he will go to the this URL. I'll just last thing, I'm also going into this, the dashboard part of this. You can go to this dashboard. And this dashboard request and response, and it will go to this request and response. It will give you this API. So you can use this API, this post REST API, if you have worked on this post this API request URL and all this submit a request input parameters, everything is there. Your sample code is also there, which you can directly embed in your any application. It generates a Python code for this. You can use it for the REST API. So this is a web service created. Many modes you can utilize this web service. So you can utilize, you can use it for the batch execution also, for entering multiple queries you can use this. And am I lost?
Sorry, your screen is not visible.
So I was talking that you can use this for batch execution also, for batch execution, which means many, you guys must be knowing batch execution. So for batch execution, you can also use when you are having, you want to set up like for a particular time, you can utilize this. And for dashboard also, this is a configuration of this web service. It will give you this configuration that enables sample data, display name, and this input schema is there. And this is the output schema. Okay, this is the one. And another thing is what you can do is for this web service. Here, the request response basically. Previous version of submit request, submit a request, input parameters, and this all. Everything related to your web service is there. You can utilize it. Okay, from here you can utilize it. So this was my a demonstration of a creation of a web service of, this is a snapshot which it gives you of this and how you can basically utilize this and for all your web service. When if you want to see, you can go to this globe which is there. You can see that this all these web service will be there, but you can go and access, like for example, every web service that you might have created. You can also, for this trained model, if you want to save it and utilize it for some other data, you can save this trained model in the trained models. Don't need to build the similar model. So sometime we use one model for some other type of data or for some same type. So no need to create these steps again. You can save this in the trained models. All these models will get saved and directly you can access these trained models. So this is one more feature I like about this tool. Now, how to publish your experiment in gallery, what you can do is go to this automobile prize experiment, which is already there. This is a web service which you created, but go to experiments and these experiments will pop up. Automobile prize prediction, this is the one. And in this publish to gallery, it will just a minute. Okay. Go to this publish to gallery. Just write your experiment name. This is very helpful for your portfolio. Tag your content and summarize your experiment. Write some description about that. Go to the next page. Upload a good photo of your experiment and from anywhere. And from just public visibility, public or visible, you want to specifically visible, make it visible for some of your faculty members or for some of your friends. You can do that also. Unlisted ones, and only people with the direct link can view and copy the experiment. And you agree. So your this experiment will get in the gallery. So you can see it like this in the gallery. Okay. Azure AI gallery, it is free. You can, and your name will come that you are the publisher of this experiment. Date will come and people can like it also. You can share it on Twitter, LinkedIn, on mail. And this is the summary which you will write. This is the window where you will write your, you will paste your photo and people can open it also. You can add to your collection and this all will be there. Okay. So this is was the demonstration of how you can use Microsoft Azure Machine Learning Studio. Okay. And hope you like it. We have covered, I think we have covered this, all the aspects which I wanted to cover for this. Okay. And I'm just want to move to my presentation. Okay. So these are all the, some standard case studies are also there. There are a lot of case studies. You want to access the face detection API. There are also deep learning APIs which are there. You can access them also. And if you want some material, I can share some material with you related to these things. I have created these materials. If you want this, I can share. So thanks a lot for your time. We have covered this, develop machine learning models, algorithm selection, initialize and train appropriate models. Model validation also we did, where we tried and we try and solve how the model validation is done. And we have done one, two case studies also. So deployment of machine learning models also come. I have done it, web service and web service deployment. Consume, I have shown you how you can consume them with the help of gallery, with the help of web service, with the help of Excel also. And then add-ons, you want to manage your machine learning projects and workspaces. Then these are all the add-ons which are there. Thanks a lot for your time.
Thank you, sir.
I can take some questions if you have. Sorry, it took some more amount time because I went in some detail. So apologies if I have exceeded the time limit. I hope you might have, this would have be informative for you. I hope you will utilize this. I hope this session, you like this session. I hope this, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Now I would like to invite Professor Sonal Yadav, coordinator of this event, to deliver welcome address. To deliver vote of thanks.
Thank you so much, Rashmi ma'am. It's a great honor for me to give vote of thanks. First of all, I would like to give heartfelt gratitude to our chief guest, Dr. S.P. Chaube, three coordinator, RGPB Bhopal, for giving us the opportunity for conducting a great session and for gracing our program and delivering the inaugural address today. Thank you, sir, for sharing knowledge on cloud computing and always giving your gracious presence in our event. I'm also very much thankful to Sri Shyam Rathore, Chairman, Truba Group of Institutes, Bhopal, for his continuous support and advices, which greatly help us towards the successful event. I also sincerely thank Dr. Rajiv Arya, Director, Truba Institute of Engineering and Information Technology, for his gracious presence. I am again very pleased to thank Professor Manoj Tyagi, HODCS Department and in charge principal, Truba College of Science and Technology, for his inspiring mentorship and continuous support. With this great attitude, With this great gratitude, I would like to give a big thanks to our expert, Mr. Vaibhav Jain, for delivering such a wonderful and knowledgeable session for us. And really, sir, you have shared a very practical knowledge with all of us. I hope that all the students and faculties learned a lot from you today. I also want to thank Professor Rashmi Singh, HOD Basic Science Department, Trubha College of Science and Technology, for her coordination for conducting this event. I'm so pleased to give heartfelt thanks to Professor Chandan Kumar, coordinator of this one-day workshop, for his continuous efforts to organize such a wonderful event. Last but not the least, I would like to thank to my colleague, Professor Irfan Khan, who has given his 100% effort in organizing this one-day workshop and give us undemanding support and assistance for making this event successful. At last, I am extremely privileged to have you all participants here today. Feedback link is already shared in the chat box and in YouTube also. Okay, so all have to fill that feedback link till 7 p.m. today. I am repeating, that feedback link is mandatory to fill and time limit is till 7 p.m. today only. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thanks to each and everyone. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
So we should end it, Tyagi sir?
Yes, madam.
Okay, sir. Irfan sir, end the meeting.
Okay.
Thank you.